أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين الغر الميامين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا ثم اللعنة الدائمة الأبدية على أعدائهم ومنكري فضائلهم ومناقبهم وغاصبي حقوقهم وقاتليهم إلى يوم الدين صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله صلى الله عليك يا مولاي وابن مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة ويا عبرة كل مؤمن ومؤمنة روحي وأرواح العالمين لك الفدا يا غريب يا مظلوم كربلاء سيدي يا ليتنا كنا معكم فنفوز فوزا عظيما السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك وأناخت برحلك عليكم جميعا مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن وعلى أولاد وعلى أصحاب الحسين السلام عليك وعلى أخيك بالفضل العباس وعلى أختك الحوراء زينب وعلى أم البنين ورحمة الله وبركاته. The final night of this majlis, we raise our hands to salute the master of martyrs, Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us in our lifetime to visit the Imam, a true ziyarah, a true visit, and to have his shafa'ah in the akhirah. Hussein, ya Hussein, Hussein, ya Abdullah, Hussein, ya Hussein, 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 ya Hussein, Hussein. صلى الله عليك يا مولاي بأبي أنت وأمي يا أبا عبد الله. In this very night, We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the shafa'ah of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad bi barakat salati ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. For qabool al-a'mal, for qada' al-hawa'ij, for the patience that many people have asked me to do dua for their family members and to hasten the reappearance of our awaited Imam Sahib al-Asr wa al-Zaman, a second louder salawat. For your well-being, brothers and sisters in the majlis, for I am honored during these 12 nights that I have been given this opportunity to serve this wonderful and generous community. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep up these majalis for you to be blessed and to be able to continue serving Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam for your well-being and the well-being of the Zuwar of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, a third louder salawat. وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ وَإِنَّهَا لَكَبِيرَةٌ إِلَّا عَلَى الْخَاشِعِينَ. Tonight, I wanted to emphasize a little bit on the importance of patience. But before I do that, let me give a small introduction. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in many areas in the Holy Quran describes to us how He created man. When I say man, I mean that creation that was so weak when he was in the womb of his mother. When he came to this world, again he was weak. He was in need of external help and support until he was able to rely on himself. The infant, when it is in the womb of the mother, it always needs continuous feeding. So in that sense, the infant or the unborn child needs help. It's weak. This is one of its weaknesses. Once this infant is born, again, it will need continuous help and support for it to be able to live. One of the weaknesses in the infant is that if it's not fed every couple of hours, it will start crying. Why? Because it's a need. When you are in need, that means you have a weakness. When the baby's diapers are not changed, when the clothing is to be changed and it doesn't get changed very often, you see the child or the infant starts crying. Why? Because it feels uneasy, unhappy, and that source comes from its needs for his clothing to be changed. So that is a weakness. He or she, they can't do that themselves. They are always in need of external help, external individual to help them. So that is a weakness that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about these weaknesses in the Holy Quran by saying, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَخَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ضَعْفٍ. ضَعْف, weakness. Until the child grows up, until 18, 19, 20, 21, until that age, we see some individuals, they are still in need of their parents' help. They still have that weakness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues speaking about dha'af until man reaches the age of 40. By man, I mean men and women. Mankind, human beings. Until we reach the age of 40, before that we are always in need of help. Okay, physically we might not need any help. Maybe our parents, they need us to help them. Maybe we have the strength. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not only speak about physical abilities. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also speaks to us about our intellects, our mental abilities. That's why you see some children, when they are born with physical and mental issues. They grow, physically they grow, but mentally their aql is smaller, is younger, is still as if they are two or three, or they are four. Physically they may be strong. That's why you see some of the patients who have some problems in terms of their intellect and their aql, physically their muscles are tend to be stronger than normal average human beings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them that power, but aql wise, intellect wise, they lack the understanding, they lack the intellect, so they are still in dha'f. That's why anyone before the age of 40, they still are in dha'f intellectually. That's why many of Allah's prophets, when they reached the age of 40, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent them to prophethood. They were prophets from before they came to this world. But the actual responsibility of tabligh, of the message of the risala, started when they were 40. Why? It's not that their aql was not complete, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to set an example that at the age of 40, man reaches complete wisdom. So these are some of the examples that we, when we come to this world, until we reach that age, we are in continuous need of help. وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. And seek, استعين. استعين means ask for help. استنصار means asking for support. Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, one of his positions on the day of Ashura was that he was begging for help. Istinsar. Once your appearance says that you need help. Maybe you're carrying a heavy object, someone sees you, they automatically, without you saying anything, they will come and help you with carrying that object. That is talab al-awn. But sometimes, no, you ask someone, you do istinsar, you ask someone to come and help you. Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, as I said, talaban musrah, he asks for help, he asks for support. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran says, wasta'inu, ask for help. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you in your weaknesses. And seek help and assistance with patience. بالصبر والصلاة. With patience, perseverance, and prayer. It is indeed hard. وَإِنَّهَا لَكَبِيرَةً. Normal men, normal women, those who they are working towards reaching that ultimate level of taqwa and piety and iman, they see sometimes that salah may be a bit hard, a bit difficult on them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, use some patience. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Astaeenu بالصبر والصلاة. إنها لكبيرة. It is as if I see it something really huge. I can't wait until I finish my salah. I can't wait until I finish my dua. When I think with myself, I should recite the Holy Quran, I think it's something really hard, difficult. As if you are asking me to break down the mountain. Shouldn't be. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. إِنَّهَا لَكَبِيرَةٌ إِلَّا عَلَى الْخَاشِعِينَ. It is big, it is hard, except to those who bring a lowly spirit, a soul, a spirit which is so low that it doesn't think about salah and patience to be something really hard. Devotion. You have to devote yourself. The same way husband devotes himself to support his wife, to support his family, the same way we human beings devote ourselves to our jobs, we devote ourselves to individuals who we love and show affections to, we have to devote ourselves to salah. Salah is not only ruku and sujood and reciting, that's it. I will come to explain the different types of salah. There are times where you pray, but you don't realize that this prayer has affected you. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Ahlul Bayt, on many occasions they come and say to you, if your salah is not preventing you from committing mistakes, committing sins, that salah is not worth anything. إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر. One example of patience. There was a man called Abu Talha al-Ansari. He was the one that welcomed the Holy Prophet صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. He welcomed the Messenger of Allah in his house when the Holy Prophet migrated from Mecca to Medina. So the first house the Holy Prophet went into was the house of Abu Talha al-Ansari. This Abu Talha, when he was young, he went to ask the hand of Ummu Salim for marriage. Ummu Salim, a very noble, a very practicing, a mu'mina in the city of Medina. But many people went to ask her hand in marriage. But she had many wishes. This Abu Talha, he was a kafir. He was young. Shaitan had manipulated his mind. So he came to ask Ummu Salim's hand in marriage. Ummu Salim had one wish. She said to him, I will accept to get married to you, but my wish is that you become a Muslim. You know, when the love hits, you will do anything for it. You will go crazy. Ummu Salim said to Abu Talha, I want you to become a Muslim, then I will get married to you. He became Muslim. And then his Islam became so sincere that he welcomed the Messenger of Allah and he served the Holy Prophet. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon him. Between brackets, there are some people, they become Muslims, they become Shia, but it's not from their bottom of the hearts. It's because so-and-so asked me to become Muslim, I became Muslim. Or become Shia, I became Shia. Because my father is saying to me, pray, I am praying. But I'm not praying because I believe in praying. I am doing this good because my father, my parents are saying to me, do it, but I don't believe in it. There was a friend of ours. When he was young, his father used to push him towards Salah. He was young, very, very small. When he used to stand in front of the Qibla and want to do niyyah, he used to say, Usalli Salat al-Dhuhr mathalan, because my dad is saying to me. We don't want that kind of Salah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to pray the prayer that will have a positive effect on you, that you believe in everything you're saying. So Abu Talha and Ummu Salim, they get married. They have children. Their first child was Talha. They named him Talha. Okay. Abu Talha goes out to work. This Talha one day falls ill and dies at home. Here is a good wife. she covers his body, closes the door, doesn't show on her face what strength in the times of masa'ib. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what does he say in the Holy Quran? الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَبَشِّرَ الصَّابِرِينَ. Before that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَبَشِّرَ الصَّابِرِينَ, and give glad tidings. To who? To the mu'mineen. Mu'mineen, sometimes they are lacking that aspect of patience. Allah says, وَبَشِّرَ الصَّابِرِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Eventually, I will go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am from Allah, and I will go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Regardless of what pain, regardless of what problems Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends to me as a result of test, imtihan. So she covers him, she closes the door. Abu Talha, back from work, tired. He asks, how are you? How is things? How is Talha? Where is he? I can't see him. She says to him, Talha is asleep. And he was asleep. Death is one sign of, or when you sleep, it is one sign of death. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides whether you wake up from that sleep or not. Abu Talha eats his lunch, his dinner, rests a little bit. A few hours later, she wants to give him the news. Again, what do we learn from this noble lady? That when there is a calamity, when there is a problem, don't go straight away as soon as they open the door, say, oh, so-and-so, did you hear something happened? Because physically, that is not good. They might get attacked and fall and die themselves. Abu Talha say, Ummu Salim says to Abu Talha, if your neighbor one day gives you an amana, gives you something to look after, how well will you look after this amana? He said, of course, this is amana. At the end, you have to give it back. It's not mine. When you give back this amana, how pleased would the neighbor be? And how pleased would you be that you've looked after this amana? Abu Talha says, I would be very pleased. I would be very happy. And of course, my neighbor will be very happy with me as well. Umm Salim says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us Talha as an amana, and he's taken his amana. Now when he saw that his wife, a mother, with strong sabr, he as a man, he was embarrassed to show that he was going to cry or to collapse. He also was patient. He came, he prepared his son, he buried him, and then he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said to him, O Prophet of Allah, this is the story. I came home, my son was dead, but my wife didn't tell me straight away. She prepared the environment in a way where I accepted in the least of damages. You know what the Holy Prophet said? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi says, I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that in my nation there are individuals like Umm Salim. We in our religion, we should be like that. Every time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us in anything. Sometimes Allah tests us in our deen. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us in our wealth, in our children, in our home, outside home, in our work, in our education, in our exams, in our health, in our security. He wants to see how patient we are. Imam Ali alayhi salam says, As-sabru fil umur, patience and calamities and problems, bimathabat al-ra'si min al-jasad. Patience, when you're in a problem and you have patience, is like a head to its body. When the head is spoiled, when the head is separated from the body, then the body can't be used anymore. It's useless. Imam Ali alayhi salam says, As-sabr fi al-umur bimathabat al-ra'si min al-jasad. Idha fasada al-ra'si fasada al-jasad. if there is no sabr, you will be corrupted. You will be corrupted. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let me remind ourselves, brothers and sisters, about the verses in the Holy Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Asr, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Al-Asr, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what? Al-insan lafi khusr. Insan came to this world as a weak individual. He's always, his age is ticking, the clock is ticking. His age every day becomes to a minus. Fi khusr. He's losing his life. Now, we started our majalis from the night of the 1st of Muharram, 1437. There will no longer be 1st of Muharram, 1437. Next year will be 1438, the year after 1439. Never will you have another year, 1437. This time, this Sunday that I am sitting with you here, you will never have that back. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Not only they do justice, not only they themselves are patient, but they advise those around them to do good, to do justice, to be patient. In another verse, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصابرين. Allah is with you. You're safe. من كان مع الله كان الله معه. They ask Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, they say, do you see the one that you worship? I am always with Allah. Allah is always with me. Whatever I do, before I do something, I see Allah with it. As I am doing that action, I see Allah with it. After I do that action, I see Allah. So the start, before I start, the introduction, doing that action, the conclusion has to always have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with it. Imam says, كيف لا أعبد من لا أراه. How can I worship someone that I cannot sense? I sense the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in me, in my actions. إنما يوفى الصابرون أجرهم بغير حساب. Then when you are patient, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you your reward. Someone who works 5 days, 7 days a week, from the day, from the morning until the evening, at the end of the week when they are paid to pay him, he is very happy. Now here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the sabr, the one that is patient, Allah will reward him. Amir al-Mu'mineen again comes and says, أَلَا وَإِنَّ لِكُلِّ مَأْمُومٍ إِمَامٌ يُقْتَدَى بِهِ أَوْ يَقْتَدِي بِهِ. Every man should have an imam, or must have an imam. أَلَا وَلِكُلِّ مَأْمُومٍ إِمَامٌ. When you pray Salat Jama'ah, you are the ma'moom, and the imam is the one that leads the salah. So you are following the imam. Imam alayhi salam is saying, أَلَا وَإِنَّ لِكُلِّ مَأْمُومٍ إِمَامٌ يَقْتَدِي بِهِ. Follows. وَيَسْتَضِيءُ بِنُورِ عِلْمِهِ. And uses, make sure the one that you follow has knowledge. What kind of knowledge? A knowledge that will guide you through darkness. إِنَّ الْحُسَيْنِ سَفِينَةُ النَّجَاةِ مِصْبَاحُ الْهُدَى وَسَفِينَةُ النَّجَاةِ. Rasulullah says, when I went to the heavens, I read, written, عَلَى سَاقِ الْعَرْشِ, on the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does it say? It says, إِنَّ الْحُسَيْنَ مِصْبَاحُ الْهُدَى وَسَفِينَةُ النَّجَاةِ. صلى على محمد وآل محمد. Hussein is the lantern of guidance. He is an imam. He has knowledge. Then that knowledge should guide you in the darkness. Imam Hussein is a lantern of guidance. And the ark of salvation, they asked Imam Rida alayhi salam, oh Imam, are you not all lanterns of guidance? Are you not all arks of salvations? But why do you emphasize on Abi Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam? They said, Imams, they themselves said, ولكن إن سفينة الحسين أوسع وفي لجج البحار أسرع. The ark of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn is bigger, is massive, is huge. It can take on many people. وفي لجج البحار. And when it's time that all the tides of darkness is hitting you, the ark of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn is faster to guide you, to take you to land of salvation in the middle of, in the midst of all of the problems. إنما يوفى الصابرون أجرهم بغير حساب. وبشر الصابرين الذين إذا أصابتهم مصيبة قالوا إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. أمير المؤمنين continues to say, ويستضيء بنور علمه ألا وإن إمامكم. He says, your imam, imam is speaking by himself. ألا وإن إمامكم قد اكتفى من دنياه بطمريه ومن طعمه بقرصيه ألا وإنكم لا تقدرون على ذلك. He says, your imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, he has only taken from this dunya two pieces of cloth. Amir al-Mu'mineen used to have two pieces of cloth as clothing that he used to cover his body with. وَمِن طُعَمِهِ بِقُرْصَيْهِ. He used to only have two pieces of dried bread made of barley or oats. Very hard, very difficult to break. No one was able to break the bread that that Amir al-Mu'mineen used to eat. Imam says, you won't be able to do that. ألا وإنكم لا تقدرون على ذلك. Okay, Imam, what shall we do? Advise us. We want to follow you. You will be our Imam. You will guide us. ألا وإنكم لا تقدرون على ذلك. ولكن أعينوني بورع واجتهاد. He, Imam, is asking you to support him, to help him in this. Imam is advising us. The Imam is saying, help me. How? Be devout, wara, be pious. Imam is asking us, the Shia, the followers, to be devout and pious in our religion. Ala, wa innakum la taqdiruna ala thalik, walakin a'inuni bi wara'in wa ijtihad wa affatin wa sadad. Be chastised, have chastity. Have rightness, have purity, be pious. This is to brothers and sisters. Wara, ijtihad, work hard, seek knowledge. Iffah, sadad, nobleness. This is how we can help Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam in our lifetime. So man is so weak that every time he needs help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do we not recite in dua kumail? Ilahi wa sayyidi wa maulai man li ghayruk. I have no one else apart from you, O Allah. I had my mother went. I had my father passed away. من لي غيرك أسأله كشف ضري والنظر في أمري. Oh Allah, I have no one else. No one else but you, oh Allah. Okay, how do we become patient? بالصبر والصلاة. Sabr in this verse, Mufassirin come and say it is fasting. Salah is salah. Be patient. Stay hard in your iman and religion. Perseverance in fasting and salah. In one of the dua that we recite in Shahr Ramadan, just between brackets, is this dua. Allahumma ij'al siyami fihi siyam as-sa'imin wa qiyami qiyam al-qa'imin wa nabbihni an nawmat al-ghafilin. You ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, help me in a way where my fasting is the fasting of those who fast. Do we not all fast? Yes, we do fast, but there are three different types of fasting. One type of fasting is that we don't eat and drink. That's one type that, you know, the billions of people who fast, they fast from eating and drinking. This is the normal fasting. As-siyam al-aam, normal, general. The second type of fasting is when your jawarih, when your eyes, your ears, your tongue, your hands, your legs, they all fast. Your eyes is fasting, your ears is fasting, your hands, you don't go using your legs, you don't go to do something haram. That is also fasting. And the third type of fasting is the fasting of the Anbiya and the Imams. Can we reach that level? Not only that they don't eat and drink, not only that their jawarih don't commit haram, their heart is fasting as well. They don't think of doing haram. Sometimes in the second part, we may think to do haram. We might think to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, stay patient, have sabr. Because that is the fasting that will be accepted from you. That's why Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, they come and advise us that don't only fast in Shahr Ramadan. Fast every week, Mondays and Thursdays. Fast. Because fasting cleanses your soul. Not only don't eat and drink, fast so your jawarih fast as well. You want to reach that level of piety? Just fasting. Okay, salah. Ista'inu bis-sabri, fasting, was-salah. Okay, are there different types of salah as well? Yes. There is the salah again, that you stand in front of the Qibla, Allahu Akbar, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wala al-dhalin, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Your salah doesn't affect you in any way. That's it. It's as if you were doing some sports. Going down, coming up. As an example, 1 year a companion asked Imam Zain al-Abidin in Hajj, MashaAllah, look at all the Hajj. Look at everyone rotating around the Kaaba. Imam alayhi salam told him, don't say ma akthar al-hajij. Say ma akthar al-dhajij wa aqall al-hajij. Akthar al-dhajij. This is all noises. They're occupying space. But the real hujjaj are the ones that when they say labbaik Allahumma labbaik, not only is words they utter, it's everything. Oh Allah, labbaik, I have come to you. I have left the world behind me. That's why they say, someone who is sincere, they have fulfilled their hajj in the best of manners. When he goes back to his family, كَأَنَّهُ يَوْمٌ وَلَدَتْهُ أُمُّهُ. The day that you come to this world without sins, it's like that. He says, oh Imam, there are thousands of people wearing the ihram, doing hajj. So only a small, minute number of them are real hajj. The Imam said, yes. Do you want me to show you? He said, what do you mean, Imam? He said, close your eyes. Imam placed his hand over his eyes. He said, open your eyes. He opened his eyes. He saw a bunch of goats, a bunch of monkeys, a bunch of wolves, a bunch of pigs rotating around the Kaaba. Imam saw that he was frightened. Imam placed his hand over his eyes again. He became normal. He said, Imam, what was this? Imam told him, this is the reality of the people that are doing Hajj. So nowadays, don't be surprised that you see millions of people go to Hajj. You will be surprised the stories that we hear people do in Hajj. A wife says to her husband, I am going to Hajj, from one of the Khaliji Arabic countries. The wife, the husband, my wife is mashallah, mu'mina, she goes to Hajj. She goes to Hajj. But in time of Hajj, she's placed an appointment with her boyfriend to meet her in Mecca. And the husband, this poor man, is sitting there saying, my wife is saying, labbaik Allahumma labbaik. Who are we kidding? Are we kidding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Then, استعينوا بالصبر والصلاة. And then we, in the dua that I recited for شهر رمضان, we say, اللهم اجعل صيامي فيه صيام الصائمين. Sa'imeen are those third category that their hearts as well fast. وَقِيَامِ قِيَامَ الْقَائِمِينَ قَائِمِينَ. When you stand in front of Abi Abdullah and you say, أَشْهَدُ أَنَّكَ قَدْ أَقَمْتَ الصَّلَاةِ. You don't say, أَشْهَدُ أَنَّكَ صَلَّيْتَ. Because praying and doing إِقَامَ of salah are two different things. You say, oh Imam, I bear witness that you manifested the soul of Salah on the day of Ashura. Ashhadu annaka qad aqamta as-salat, iqama of Salah. And then you say, wa nabbihni, oh Lord, nabbihni an nawmatil ghafilin. Again, there are different types of Noma. Noma is when you sleep. So there are times where you sleep on the bed, you rest, and there are times where no, you sleep, you are drugged, you don't know what's happening around you. You are full of desire of this world, you're running behind this world. This is Nomatul Ghafileen. Let me explain to you very quickly, and inshallah I will conclude my majlis. Brothers and sisters, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There are 7 types of nom. And I will give you the times when it is good advice for you to rest, to sleep, or the times that you are cursed if you sleep in those hours. There is one type of noma which is called the noma to la'na. The person is sleeping, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will curse him for sleeping in that time. What time is that? Bayna tulu'ayn. Bayna tulu'ayn is from the start of the time of the Fajr, where you have to pray until tulu' al-shams. If someone is sleeping in that time and misses salah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will curse him. Okay, if you wake up and pray, stay awake until sun is up. Because this is when the rizq, the sustenance will come down. The malaika carrying your rizq for that day, they come in that time. بَيْنَ الطُّلُعَيْنِ. So this is نَوْمَةُ الْلَعْنَةِ. نَوْمَةُ الْجَاهِلِ. The resting of a jahil, of an ignorant. And that is in the morning. Let's say 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock. There are some individuals, they stay awake all night. Not because they were doing ibadah, you know, out with their friends, doing nothing constructive. They stay awake all night and then they start sleeping at 7, 8 o'clock in the morning. This is nawmatu jahil. Allah calls you ignorant. Nawmatu ni'mah. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls this a ni'mah, good for your body. And this is called qaylula. When this is at 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, before Salat al-Dhuhr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says this is ni'mah for you. Rest so you can pray in the best of health. The next one, nawmatul hamq, ahmaq, is the one that he prays when Salat al-Dhuhr is being said, the adhan, he prays, he misses Salat al-Dhuhr. Or the one that prays after, or sleeps after Salat al-Dhuhr. This person is ahmaq. Nawmatul afiyah. Nawmatul afiyah. When you finish your salah, and you've eaten, you've sat down with the children, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ahlul Bayt advise you to sleep a little bit. Afternoon, not asr. Not late afternoon, in the beginning of the afternoon. Have some rest. This will have afiyah for your body. Nawmatul ghafla. وَنَبِّهْنِي عَنْ نَوْمَةِ الْغَافِلِينَ. Ghafilin are those individuals who sleep at the time of Salatul Layl. When there are mu'mineen, mu'minat awake in the middle of the night, they are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are speaking and talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and other people are asleep. That sleep is called ghafla. You are ghafil. You don't know what you're missing. أَمَّا اللَّيْلِ فَهُمْ صَافُونَ أَقْدَامَهُمْ يَقْرَؤُونَ الْقُرْآنَ يُحَزِّنُونَ بِهِ أَنفُسَهُمْ فَهُمْ وَالْجَنَّةُ كَمَنْ رَآهَا فَهُمْ فِيهَا مُنَعَّمُونَ فَهُمْ وَالنَّارُ كَمَنْ قَدْ رَآهَا فَهُمْ فِيهَا مُعَذَّبُونَ. Amir al-Mu'mineen says to his companion Hammam. Hammam came to him. Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, Sifli al-Muttaqeen. Describe to me the pious. Imam says, oh Hammam, you will not be able to take in those descriptions. Hammam says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, zidni, give me, I will be able to. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, Ya Hammam, they are individuals that at night when everyone is asleep, safuna aqdamahum, their legs are next to each other, standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in dua, in prayer. أما الليل فهم صافون أقدامهم يقرؤون القرآن يحزنون به أنفسهم. When they read verses of the Holy Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the non-believer, the non-mu'min, they make themselves become upset. Oh Allah, inshallah, I am not part of those. فَهُمْ وَالْجَنَّةُ كَمَنْ قَدْ رَآهَا. It's as if they see the paradise. فَهُمْ فِيهَا مُنَعَّمُونَ. And then, وَهُمْ كَالنَّارُ كَمَنْ قَدْ رَآهَا فَهُمْ فِيهَا مُعَذَّبُونَ. It's as if they see hellfire and that they are being punished. This is it. My lecture here ends. Now I want to read Masa'ib. One of the companions of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, his name is written with the Shuhada. His name is Al-Hafhaf ibn al-Muhannad al-Rasibi. He is one of the companions that used to come from the city of Basra. Now everyone knows that all the companions were martyred before Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. But this individual, he set off from Basra to come to Abi Abdullah al-Hussein to sacrifice his life for Abi Abdullah. But once he arrived, he noticed that the tents were burnt. He noticed that the body of Abi Abdullah was lying on the plains of Karbala. He came forward, he saw a group of men dancing, singing, drinking alcohol. He came to them, he asked them, where is Sayyid al-Shuhada, where is Abi Abdullah? They said to him, why are you asking, who are you? He said to them, I am Al-Hafhaf ibn al-Muhannad al-Rasibi. I have come so I can stand in the camp of my master Hussein and sacrifice myself for him. They said to him, you are too late. Hussein has been killed, and this is his head on top of a spear. Then he became angry. You are dancing, you are singing. He took out his sword. It is narrated that he killed 28 armed men. They all came around him, surrounded him until he became a martyr. Later on, Imam Zain al-Abidin buried him with the martyrs. They separated his head. They took his head towards Kufa. That was one incident. But today, day 11, what happened? Today,
عيد الكرب to أهل البيت عليهم السلام. They came to Lady Zainab. They said, get ready, we have to take you to Kufa. In what state? Lady Zainab remembers the day that she entered Karbala. She entered with her brother Abbas, with her brother Hussein, with Ali al-Akbar. She started collecting the children until she noticed two children of Imam Hassan, one for Imam Hassan and one from Imam Hussein. Their names were the two girls. Their names were Umm al-Hassan. The other name was Umm al-Hussein. Two of them are not there. She went out. She started looking for them until she found them. But in what state, brothers and sisters? She found them. Umm al-Hussein, little girls, 5-6 years old. Umm al-Hussein had hugged Umm al-Hussein, and they both had died as a result of this. This is one of the calamities of Karbala. It is today, the 11th day of Muharram, that they came, they started separating the heads of the shuhada. Every clan, every tribe, they wanted to seek nearness to Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. So they went and started collecting ahead of a shaheed. There was one man, ajarakallah ya sahib al-zamaid. There was one man who was looking for a head, he couldn't find anyone. I recited this musibah on the night of Ashura, but let me repeat it again. He came, he started looking for a head, he couldn't find one. He remembered that Abu Abdullah took little Ali al-Azhar behind the tent. He never knew where the tent was because the tents were burnt. Do you know what he did? He took a spear and started digging the ground until he took out the spear. He noticed there was fresh blood on the spear. He undug the grave, took out the head of Ali al-Azhar, the little head of a 6-month-old baby on top of the spear. Now, I want to ask you, brothers and sisters, there was one more head that the enemies of Allah were not able to put on top of the spear. That was the head of Abu Fadl al-Abbas. Why? Because Abbas's head was smashed. They hit Abu Fadl on the head with an iron pillar. Well, every time that La'in came to put the head of Abbas on top of the spear, the head of Abbas used to fall. So they brought a rope, they tied the head of Abbas to the neck of a horse. Every time the horse was moving, the head of Abbas was hitting the knees of the horse. It is in that situation that Ahl al-Bayt, they were forced to leave to go to Kufa. How were they going to go up on the camels? And the camels weren't equipped. They didn't have appropriate rooms, appropriate containers, appropriate seats. Here, Lady Zainab said to Umar ibn Sa'ad, order your men to go away. I will help the women and children to go. Here, there was not enough camels. Many of the women and children were forced to walk. But Imam Zainab al-Abidin, the ill one, he wasn't able to stand. They came, every time they placed Imam on top of the camel, Imam used to fall off. So they brought ropes and they tied the hands and the legs of the Imam to the body of the camel. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un.
باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله. Brothers and sisters, raise your hands in dua. It is time of dua, time istijabat al-dua. Many people, mu'mineen, mu'minat, they ask you for dua, they ask you to mention their family members in your prayers, the ill ones, those who have hajat, parents, fathers, mothers, pray for your children. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء يا الله 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 seven times يا أرحم الراحمين 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 أو الله you are merciful أو الله the nights of Muharram are coming to an end but it is the start of the tragedies of Lady Zainab it is the start of the tragedy of the captives of the Sabaya Oh Allah, grant us to continue mourning for Imam Hussein, for Abul Fadl al-Abbas. Oh Allah, grant us to continue mourning for Lady Zainab. One way we can help Lady Zainab in her masa'ib is to stand fast in our religion, to pray on time, to look after our modesty, to look after our faith, to look after our hijab. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the sake of Sayyida Zainab, for the sake of little Ruqayya, little Sukayna, guide us towards the right path, Ya Allah. Allahumma ajjil fi faraj maulana sahib al-asri wal-zaman. We all stand in respect for Imam al-Zaman and recite this dua. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allahumma كل وليك حجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم ارزقنا زيارة الحسين اللهم ارزقنا شفاعة الحسين اللهم ارزقنا حياة محمد وآل محمد اللهم ارزقنا ممات محمد وآل محمد وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات I would like to once more thank all the brothers and sisters who participated in the organization of this majlis, especially the volunteers, the young men, the young ladies, the people who provided and supported the majlis financially by providing niyaz, everyone that attended, everyone. There are some people who worked tirelessly from the morning until the evening behind the scenes. They were not known. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all the shafa'ah of Imam Hussein alayhi salam.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you very much from the bottom of my heart. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant me another opportunity to come and serve this wonderful community. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to support the committee, the organizers, in organizing better majalis, insha'Allah, in the future. وَإِلَىٰ رَوَحِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ رَحِمَ اللَّهُ مَنْ بَعَثَ لَهُمْ ثَوَابَ سُورَةِ الْمُبَارَكَةِ الْفَاتِحَةِ مَعَ الصَّلَوَاتِ